The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines the word collective as denoting to a number of persons or things considered as one group or whole, and the word network, a usually informally interconnected group or association of persons, such as friends or professional colleagues. Finally, a penumbra is defined as a space of partial illumination, as in an eclipse, between the perfect shadow on all sides and the full light, a body of rights held to be guaranteed by implication in a civil constitution. Penumbras, Lux et Veritas, is a glimpse into the lives of artists of color, reflecting on their experiences at Yale University.
My name is Tomas Vu. I graduated in 1990, and I came out of painting and printmaking. I'd say that's probably the best thing about Yale for me, the relationship between peers and peers. I'm still friends with a large group of them. In fact, we're like a support group for each other. We see each other's show, still do studio visits and stuff like that. And I would say that's probably the most important thing about Yale.
My name is Luisa Maria Basnuevo. I went to Yale in 1989, graduated in 1991. We were pretty much on our own, independently in working in our studios. We had these sessions, I don't know if you had it when you were there, we call it the pit, and that's where we got together and communicated and discussed things. Other than that, we were working in our studios independently, isolated in that sense. You go there with your kind of way of painting, and what they did little by little was kind of like this deconstructing what you were doing. It was kind of like starting over. It was little by little. I ended up doing my last work was very linear, a lot of lines, almost like drawing. And now what I'm doing now, it has a lot to do with drawing and pre-making. And I see now the connection.
I was a Yale graduate in 1997 from the Yale School of Art. I particularly appreciated the faculty and their advising. I would say that I still maintain relationships with some of those artists, and I have also developed close relationships with some of the students. I would also say that it was very different then. When you go back to school and you have a family, I feel that we came with our little community, and so it just got bigger. A lot of those artists are still in our lives. I've been trying to find photos, but those are harder to get my hands on. But I feel I graduated, I got an award at the end of it. It was nice. I mean, it was great to just have the time to study and work.
We will be here forever. Do you understand? Forever. Forever and ever and ever and ever. We will be here forever. Do you understand that? Get what I'm saying? Forever.
Hip-hop culture changed academic culture in a lot of ways, particularly in the art world. Hip-hop culture was at first, there was a time when I was trying to get into art school in the 80s, all the art schools would reject you if you had any graffiti or anything that looked like graffiti in your portfolio, you know what I'm saying? So that the Academy was very against the aesthetic of hip-hop and the cultural expression of people of color at that time. But nonetheless, so many gifted people from the culture made it into those schools and came through holding their culture, retaining it, and using it in many ways that may not have been aesthetically clear, but still were culturally clear, and confronted the conventional aesthetic of photography, of video, of installation, and new media performance. You know what I'm saying? These things became drenched in references to hip hop by artists of color that just didn't happen in the 70s and 80s. By the 90s and 2000s, you had a lot of artists of color working on what was street culture into the academy. If it weren't for racism, I often think about what would have happened if we had a kind of cultural subjectivity, cultural respect for one another, how different our society would be if there was more balanced cultural exchange. But as it exists, hip hop is a culture of the streets that has more African retention. That has, hip hop is our academy. In my neighborhood, we had street psychologists, we had street lawyers, the whole culture kept underfoot and out of recognition. Thompson, God bless his soul, he just recently passed away, Robert Ferris Thompson. When I joined his lecture hall at Yale, he made an announcement and he said, "This is the first time that one of my informants has become one of my students." And I think that's what our generation really were. We're some of the first people to be accepted into these elite schools and basically have a chance of writing our identity into the academy that had been separate and apart from our people for the hundreds of years we've been in this country. You know, we have to really focus and make our obsidian tower, our ebony tower, our mahogany tower, our maple tower of people of color and our history in our own academic voice.
I'm Anna Sukularkis, class of 2002. I received my MFA in the sculpture department at Yale. The grad student environment changed from the first year to the second year, I think, in a lot of different ways. And I don't think it was the program or necessarily the school, but my comfort with the school and just my knowledge of being a student at Yale on campus, understanding what my role was within the community, but also understanding what I was able, how I was able to utilize a lot of different resources. A network definitely evolved from my time at Yale. I was much more connected than I started out with, obviously, with friends and classmates that I'd made in the sculpture department. And even today, there are people that I've stayed in contact with and that I text with, and a lot of good friends.
Hi, I'm Lewis Gisbert, class of 2001, MFA sculpture. So we felt like we came in, that class that was selected, came in at a very interesting time, an in-between time. And also the class that was ahead of us, the second year, was an interesting eclectic group of people. At the time, there was a really organized, effort between photography, sculpture, and painting to have cross crits and to have cross dialogue and hanging out and having friends across departments at the time. And so the students that were more idea based, concept based, and then material and process came after, found themselves looking for discourse in photography in particular, because in photography they were doing a lot of video, and in painting too, because there was a lot of painters that were also making film and video. But there's a network of Yalies and non-Yalies that are still there. But, you know, it comes and it goes. William Cordova, who graduated the following one class later, and we maintained a network. I would say the first decade after graduation, there was definitely a vibrant network of graduates and of following classes. For example, Christian Curiel, who graduated from painting a couple of classes after, who's also originally from Miami, I maintained a dialogue and connection with him. And he's currently between Miami and New Haven, and he just had a wonderful, very successful show in New Haven. Nicolene Thomas, Kehinde Wiley, which were all in the same class. There is, you know, we're aware of each other. We kind of are in conversation.
My name is Shoshana Weinberger. I graduated from Yale in 2003 from the painting and printmaking department. You know, the thing about the first year at Yale was sort of my relationship with my professors. I think the relationship with trying to explore my identity through my work, which is what I applied to Yale with and what I wanted to continue to explore. And I had a handful of professors that I could have a dialogue with, but the majority of the professors were kind of the old guard. And my second year, you know, it was sort of the same old guard and feeling a little bit like I was on a lifeboat, kind of finding myself rowing ashore by meeting and connecting with more of my peers in the painting and printmaking department, but also in the sculpture department, in photography, graphic design, and even architecture. And so critiques were often steered by the old guard, and there were lots of favoritism that seemed to be part of, I don't know, the typical patriarchy and the same sort of canon of art that we're all supposed to think about and read about and contemplate. And so I felt like I was looking to get out as soon as I could.
No!
So, Michael, why is painting dead?
My name is Mike Cloud. I graduated in 2003 with my MFA. That was probably the first time I lived away from home, was in graduate school. Didn't have that much experience in painting before I went there. When I was there, if you brought something that wasn't painting, like, you're welcome to do that, but people really wouldn't talk about it. They really only would talk about painting. So that was fine for me because it taught me how to paint better. I remember kind of everybody. It was a really good group of painters. And so I got, you know, 5 years better in the 2 years. So it was worth the effort.
In the early 2000s, art and PhD students tended to think outside of the box, using a different set of logic. their influences came from different sources that were not always part of any academic curriculum. They broadened the scope of possibilities. Artist Soul Sax foresaw many of these changes in the late 1990s when he stated, "Hip-hop was not embraced by institutions of higher learning until after the 2000s. We were in the trenches before that. Many students of color related to one another by building support groups, collectives, developing personal and professional relationships even after graduating from their programs. Some artists of color went on to participate in the Studio Museum in Harlem Artist-in-Residence program with the guidance of Lowry Stokes Sims, Thelma Golden, and Christine Kim. Other institutions like Rush Arts, directed by artist Derek Adams, and later Nico Whedon, were innovative in using commercial gallery strategies with nonprofit values to create ambitious and effective exhibitions, supporting hundreds of artists of color between 1999 and 2009. Artist Wardell Milan and Leslie Hewitt were pivotal in building a collaborative environment with fellow students Jamari Kim, William Cordova, and Rashawn Griffin. Many of these artists would later go on to create the Base Collective and the Coffee Cup Collective, organizations that echoed previous collectives like the Harry Who, the Darkroom Collective, ASCO, the Miami Black Arts Collective, Kearney Street Workshop, and the LA Rebellion.
保卫和抵御所有灵魂与肉的敌人。I'm
Jamari Kim, and I graduated from the Yale MFA Graphic Design Program in 2005. At the School of Art, there were open interdisciplinary quick sessions, artist talks, and we were also functioning within the academic institution, which had its own history. So all of this became part of the experience of grad school. As I was thinking about this, I think there was an instinctual attraction that happens and you end up gravitating towards like-minded peers. And the relationships that developed were influential and they became a support system for me that still continued after grad school. And even to this day, whether it's through actual conversations or through the work as a artist, designer, educator, it's an embodied experience that is living and breathing. And it connects us to a time period at Yale when we were there, but it also connects us further to the past before, and more importantly, to the future ahead.
I often think of entering Yale as a moment when my generation departed the 90s with a completely new set of rules and logic. A generation collectively generating alternative ideas, challenging the status quo by pausing and debunking institutionalized aesthetic standards. I was thinking of a fourth wall that constantly oscillates and is defined by alternative logic based on a spiritual component, working through interdisciplinary means and a non-linear narrative. In my work, I wanted to illuminate the synthesis of memory, ritual, and mythologies that have the capacity to disrupt, challenge, and reassess definitions of our collective landscape. I'm talking about hip-hop, Native American mathematics, sacred geometries. We were improvising on top of the rules and the rulers and being conceptualists as a state of being. There was much confusion and pushback in why we found common bonds and built support groups. We networked throughout the 2000s and we built presence despite the lack of institutionalized hip-hop scholarship, despite the lack of academic interest in our own side of the mountain. While in grad school, I also lived inside a wooden box to save money. I kept a video journal that also felt it important to document my peers, their work, their presence, our contributions. We were in the trenches and we knew we were building something different.
I'm Christian Curiel. and I graduated in 2005 from painting and printmaking. Coming from a background growing up in a sort of underprivileged urban environment in Miami, Florida, you know, where like the expectancy to go to graduate school is not even really a thing. You know, I've never been in an environment where like there's, you know, other artists that seem to be just, you know, as hungry to figure out what they're doing creatively. I guess my expectations is like, you know, you hear this thing about Yale and, you know, again, you know, coming from the background, that's unheard of. It opened up a lot of things that I wasn't exposed to growing up in the environment that I did. So I do think that it opened up my practice and helped me see things from a different perspective. Just recently, I did a solo exhibition at Next Haven, which is a new program here in New Haven that was sort of envisioned and created by Titus Kafar, who was a graduate 1 year after I graduated. And he and I have always maintained a friendship. And I'm pretty much here in New Haven because of him. He kind of lured me to come here. And then since then, I've actually taught at Yale and local university here called Southern Connecticut State University. So I've been here now about 5 years, which is crazy to me. I never thought I'd be living in New Haven. I thought for sure I'd be in Miami by now. But you know, life steers you in the way that it does sometimes, and things are pretty good right now.
That's but you look the role happens. When they're looking for somebody to arrest, but you don't look the role when you're reading a book
exactly.
And you're a political philosophy major in the political science department. I mean, it's pervasive, and we don't have a choice. So we're about to have another day of action.
Blackness at Yale, for me, it's sort of like apathy. It's, to an extent, submissiveness. It's this really important need to elevate oneself. It's sort of, I feel like Blackness at Yale has moved towards like a self-interested type of Blackness, where we want to sort of help our community, but we want to help ourselves first. And we all expect to get to that level and then, you know, sort of like trickle down economics, you know, sort of our strength and our achievements will then trickle down to the poor Black people. But we know it doesn't happen like that because we have a lot of Black elites up there that doesn't really trickle down like that. So Blackness at Yale for me is just something that I feel like I'm not really that comfortable with.
Thank you.
design t-shirts and I write poetry. And I'm trying to get back into radio because I'm hosting my own radio show, radio DJ.
And what school did you go to?
Yale University.
Yeah, shut the book up. Well, okay, I don't know what else to ask.
Want to dance?
I'm Rashayla Marie Brown, and I graduated from Yale with a BA in 2004. When I graduated from Yale with a bachelor's degree, I didn't really understand how a career in the arts or in academia would work. I think there is a huge difference between how I perceived the art world when I first started and how I perceive it now, primarily because I didn't know that there were different markets and different institutional spaces and that they had different audiences. I initially thought it was all the same. And I think a lot of people who don't have exposure to museums or a lot of cultural institutions growing up perceive it that way, because what is operating there is a class division. And a lot of times this is also a racial division. And we can only perceive it slightly in that we don't feel like we're welcome or that we can participate. And now I feel like I own every space that I walk into.
My name is Irene Small, and I graduated from the PhD program at Yale. I started in 2001 and graduated in 2008. I think in terms of thinking about contemporary art, one of the defining elements of my experience was having some interaction with the MFA program. I had come into the PhD program not having any art history background, but working in the contemporary art world. One of the things that I think really helped me in terms of maintaining my interest in contemporary art and thinking about the longer trajectories of modern and contemporary art outside of Western Europe and the United States was having dialogues with people in the MFA program and going to crits and really having a very different kind of discourse around contemporary art and what felt urgent, what were the legacies of the past that really impacted practices in the present that people were talking about in terms of crits and so forth.
My name is Nathaniel Donay. I got an MFA from Yale in 2021 and the painting and printmaking department. My grad school environment was really interesting. There was engagement with each other in terms of ideas. The experience was also interesting because I personally didn't know a lot of artists from the East Coast in this kind of intimate way. And so coming from Houston, I was able to see or hear or gather around different viewpoints and perspectives that helped my thinking grow and what I was trying to do to expand and grow. So it was very helpful in essence. Well, I guess another thing I could say about the experience at Yale was that it was really diverse and progressive. Racial-wise, gender, age, geographic locations, it seemed to be pretty genuine. The first year was where everyone was pretty much trying to figure things out. I guess you figure out who your compadres will be, the closest people you'll connect with and the people that you don't necessarily connect with. And in the second year, everything kind of smoothed out. People were pretty confident, more confident than they were in first year of what they were trying to do. And I think people were very, very interested in other people's ideas, you know, because they were very confident.
No. Create dangerously, stated author Edwige Dandika. Indeed, create dangerously.